Welcome back, folks. You're listening to a Shadow Channel podcast. I'm joined today by Captain of the Imperial Star Destroyer Nebulous, Michael Veronica Millar. I'm only referring to or referencing what's on this on this envelope that's in your room. Do you care to explain that, Mike?
Yeah.
After you've introduced yourself, of course.
Hello. Very nice to see you. I am Michael Millar, not Imperial Star Destroyer Captain Michael Veronica Millar, as it says on the envelope there. That story of the envelope is that I was at the Yes campaign for about 100 days. Well, that was my first day. I wasn't there for 100 days straight, but that was my first day. 100 days until the vote. And I had lent them one of my microphones, one of my lapel mics. And we couldn't find it on the last day I was there. And so they sent it back to me. And not an exciting story, but that the title of that gives a great indication of the type of banter that was had on the digital media team. It was a lot of crazy stuff like that on a regular basis. It was good fun.
I love the idea of you were one of those retro uniforms that they had in the 79 A New Hope.
Oh, yeah.
Because it could be what do they call them? Super Star Destroyers. They're the big ass Star Destroyers that they had to destroy in Return of the Jedi.
You know, I've forgotten so much of Star Wars lore.
Yeah.
Oh man, I was super into it when I was younger, and I think the prequels just kind of ruined it for me.
Mm.
But although I did go and see at the film festival they had on, Empire had a screening of The Empire Strikes Back.
Best film ever made.
And I went to see it, and it was great. I absolutely loved it.
Greatest coming of age story ever made, in my opinion.
Really? I mean, do you think it trumps Catcher in the Rye?
I have neither read nor seen Catcher in the Rye.
You might be a bit old for it now, yeah. But it's a good film. It's a film. It's a great book.
You say I might be a bit old for it?
Yeah, I think you've got to read it when you're a teenager.
Really?
I think
I always associated it with the kind of thing that, or is it just latent leftism?
It's not political. It's not political. No. I think
stimulates the genitals of your bog standard 16-year-old.
I think to be kind of that grumpy, angsty teenager, I think that's the great mindset that you've got to be in for it, and you can appreciate it, you know, as you're older. But I think if you read it at the right stage, then it gets right into your mindset.
I just associate it with I think the gent who shot John Lennon had it on him, didn't he?
Yeah.
And I associate it with people say, "Oh, read it when you're a child." In my mind, it's associated with murdering people.
Ugh.
You know, and
Ronald Reagan as well.
And if you can hear that, folks, that is Greig Hoehle and Greg Wilson and Blair Wilson shouting profusely and angrily, I think, at the television screen where presumably hearts are being roundly thrashed. It's always a shame when one of the old firm teams don't get their ass handed to them, but
that
would not be the case if they were not quite often handing other people their asses, unfortunately.
This is a sad state of Scottish football in general.
Well, he's back by popular demand, folks. I suppose my demand, so insofar as I can call that popular, maybe I myself am a sort of collective of people. That's what Laurie Piffy thinks, at least, and myself and my invisible producers, who are the masterminds behind this show. You're back by popular demand. The embargo, yes. The wool that was concealing your eyes from us, the cotton wadding that had been stuffed into your esophagus has now been removed.
I wouldn't call it an embargo. I was part of the digital media team at Yes Scotland. I was one of the video volunteers. And so I helped make a lot of our YouTube videos and things like that. I went out to the launch of events and was filming around for Yes Scotland, editing a lot of the time at the office in Hope Street in Glasgow. But I wouldn't necessarily say I was under embargo. I think not necessarily for this, but I would think that I just didn't really want to speak about it while I was still there.
Understandable.
Because I think it was more of a slight professionalism, I suppose, would have been the reason that I didn't want to speak to it. But yes, you're quite right, and I am here now to discuss post referendum.
Free at last.
Yes,
free at last. God Almighty, we are free at last.
Not really. Just to come on and just talk about how damnably great an experience it was. Really,
I can imagine. Yeah, tell us a bit about it. I mean, the impression I got just before you do from the Yes campaign right off the bat, and being a Novor, you were a Yes voter, and it'd be easy if we both sat around and talked about how relieved I was and how disappointed you were. It'd be really easy, and it's a conversation which is simultaneously being had all over Scotland and to some extent the UK and the world, depending on who was tuned in and where and how much they cared about this particular issue. Momentous occasion. I mean, whatever you felt about the referendum, I don't suppose you were the same as me in that you took your own views out of it for a second and said, you know, it's like that Chinese proverb, may you live in interesting times. And you were aware, at least I was, I don't know if you were, you're you were aware that, wow, this is a time that's going to be in the history books. This campaign is going to go down in history because it was such a contentious and it was such an amazing period, depending on your definition of the word amazing, whether you feel positive amazing, negative amazing, meh amazing. It was an amazing period to live through. And how did you feel about it while it was going on?
I mean, I felt extremely extremely privileged to have been a part of it, because I felt that every time that I went through and made a video, that I was leaving some type of fingerprint on the campaign. And that was really what is so amazing to me still, is to think that, you know, I did that, and I'm only 22 years old. I think that, you know, to be involved in political campaigning so young is something that is pretty exclusive to our generation, I feel. Yeah. I feel that, you know, the people who would have had to contribute at the office, you know, at the headquarters level in previous generations would have had to have been much older and much more experienced. But I think that comes with a lot of the changing of the guard in how digital has taken over. And I think that was a huge asset of what we did at Yes Scotland. It was very yes focused.
It was extremely yes focused.
Digital focused. And I think that was probably the area, one of the areas in which we excelled the most.
I felt that at the time. I mean, I think to this day, Yes Scotland has twice as many Twitter followers as Better Together or Sons of United Dawn or Love Scotland Vote No or you know, No Thanks or whatever they were called. I think they took No Thanks. They took that from the Quebecan referendum, which was
maybe
the words No Thanks in French, which I imagine sounded lovely. music to the ears. But yeah, they did seem to excel and completely eclipsed the No campaign in terms of their social media presence. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I agree with you. It must be quite exhilarating for someone like you.
I believe that could have been a Hearts goal, or maybe a Hearts.
Maybe a Hearts goal. Maybe, you know, it's 3-0 now. Who knows? If a few minutes ago was anything to go by, it would appear that it's already 2-0 down. Mm-hmm. If you're Hearts, anyway. There must be something exhilarating about leaving residue on that historical blackboard or that chalkboard, just a tiny little print, and there's you know.
Oh yeah, and I think one of the great advantages of that is that it wasn't just us who were involved at the office as well. I think that because of how inviting Yes Scotland were as an online presence, it got people into doing some very creative stuff. You know, so many people who are writing songs about Yes or doing little videos pointing out things, or even if it was, you know, even if it was something outlandishly creative involving a Yes vote, I think that we were very much engaged with our audience. And so one of the great parts is, you know, we of course were involved at the office, but I think that everybody who has anybody who had a computer could get involved on Twitter or anything like that, and other areas were brilliant at doing so. National Collective were absolutely astonishing on Twitter with the stuff that they did, and so it was a great network that was kind of created online, and that has never been seen in any type of political engagement I've seen worldwide. About you know, why you should vote one way or the other. Everybody was just totally involved, and that was one of the greatest things. Yeah. About the entire campaign.
There were a plethora of different groups involved on the Yes side, and then also there were a few, but far, far fewer, I think, comparatively. And there was also, I think, Radical Independence, there were Wings Over Scotland, and Greig Hoehle is here with us. Greig, how'd you feel about the referendum that recently went down in Scotland and around the world? Go on. Speak into the microphone.
Oh, I'm on air right now.
You're on air. You're not live.
I'm not live.
No, but the little red light is flashing, which means you're now part of the
conversation. I'm in the game. Oh, yeah. I'm bitterly disappointed. Yeah. I was glad the night before when it came out, and then the next game day, I was realized I had made a huge mistake and
immediately regretted it. Yeah. Okay. Can I say that you're looking good? Then? Good.
What's the heart score?
1-0 Celtic.
Oh, still.
Still 1-0 Celtic. Just at the bar, though. Hearts will do your hearts fine.
Well,
stadium's a little sparsely populated.
Standard Celtic chat. Can't bring the fans in. Yeah. I'm like, Hearts will sell out everything.
Well, usually you have to bribe them.
Potatoes.
I can say that. My family are Irish. I can fucking say that, alright?
That's my excuse.
I'm allowed to be a bigoted son of a bitch.
Yeah.
I'm well away from that.
It's like when I say, like, I am
no
like,
way.
When I say something homophobic, I'm nothing against gay people, but I say something homophobic as a joke, and I say, oh, it's okay, my brother's the same thing.
Well, you know, Darren, he messaged me last night. He said, oh, you gotta add my friend on Facebook. I would have suggested email, but you know, I understand that you probably don't know what emails are.
And
like,
too new.
I was like, that's
that.
Not true. Some of my best friends use email. Yeah, man. But we're talking all those groups that were involved in Yes, man, like Radical Independence, Wings Over Scotland, I think, as well. They came around to my door. Yeah. Very pushy and smug they were too, but nice people for the most part. This guy claimed he had like trekked all around former Yugoslavia with his backpack, and I was like, well, you know, I'm having a good time talking to you, but were you a cunt in all 19 of those countries, or are you just a cunt now?
I think that's another part of what actually made the campaign very good, is that although on the keyboard we were exceptional, I think that, you know, you did have so many people going around the doors, like people at Radical Independence, who excelled in going into areas in which people felt disenfranchised from politics and areas,
yeah,
like Gilmerton, and they were going around with the voter registration cards and really encouraging people who maybe had never voted to go out and vote. And that was another area that was a great success of the Yes campaign. I mean, not the Yes campaign, but of the Yes vote with Radical Independence.
It was very galvanized.
Yeah, absolutely.
They did a great job of galvanizing the electorate. I mean, what was that? Let's round up 85%.
85%
on the decimal, because it was like 84 point something, wasn't it, overall? Yeah. And that is, in the 21st century, in the first world, where disillusionment with politics is very high, and the other variables in the third world that would bring it down to the level we usually have it for general elections, which I think is about 30%, 35%, is either corruption, a lack of democracy, or the kind of things you see in other parts of the world where there's voter intimidation and rigged votes and all this kind of stuff. I mean, on the point of rigged votes, though, how do you feel about this?
No, I don't believe that there's a type of rigged voting system
that's
going on. And I think that's just people who are looking for it. So I don't pay anyone.
I half sympathize with some of the people, especially the people who are saying that, who are maybe less politically engaged the rest of the time.
Uh-huh.
And there are a lot of people on both sides of the debate. Some of those loyalists gallivanting around Glasgow last weekend. Uh-huh. For 2 days, though, on social media, people pretended they had not heard of loyalists. They didn't know what loyalists were. They're like, well, they standard no voters. And I'm like, well, that would be like me comparing Yes voters to Nazi nationalists.
It's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, and loyalists are a strange breed of creature.
That is ironic. However, that I will point out that you know, a lot of people would accuse those in the Yes campaign of being nationalists. Well, what is somebody going into the city centre of Glasgow waving a British flag? Is that not nationalism? Mm. On the opposite side of the coin.
100%. Yeah. But to be fair, I think it would have been better, because I do think a lot of the people who were involved in Yes were civic nationalists, and there were a few nationalists, not even negative nationalists, but people that would wave the flag in the same way that those guys in Glasgow were waving the flag. I do think it was a little disingenuous, though, for the No campaign to pretend as though they were not also representing and opposing nationalism.
National interest,
Which I am. I also support that, opposing nationalism. I consider myself culturally British, nationalistically British, as much as I do. Scottish and nationalistically Scottish, culturally Scottish, because one is a concoction of four. The other is just an element of that overall ingredient. And I think that nations are something, and I'm going to talk about this in a show I'm doing next week. Nations are kind of, this kind of like money. They exist if you believe in them.
Mm.
You know, so people stopped believing in Yugoslavia, and now Yugoslavia is, you know, 7, 8, 9 different countries, and not 19, like I said before. I was exaggerating, obviously. That gentleman was not a cunt. He was a perfectly nice guy. He was a little
big war in there. You know, it takes a lack of belief,
yes,
and also genocide.
Yes. And there are hundreds, if not thousands, of countries that exist today, or which don't exist today, which did exist in the past.
It's a bit of a different association.
Oh,
compared
massively
to
different. I only compare them as an examination of the nature of nationalism.
Right.
What the nature of a nation is. So a nation state is what Britain is, and the proposal with Scotland would be to create a nation.
Mm.
So America's a nation state. It's a bunch of smaller entities within a larger entity. But arguably, any nation is also a nation state. I mean, you take, is France a nation state in the same way that Britain is? Well, if you look at Brittany, if you look at Aquitaine, if you look at Marseille and the region in the south, it is. Are they defined as nationalistically as Scotland and Wales, Northern Ireland and England are? Probably not.
Mm.
But you see it with Quebec. You take a country, though, like Scotland, you could argue that there's a Highland-Lowland divide, but are the Highlands and Lowlands separate countries? Well, for parts of history, the East and the West were separate countries. Kingdom of Strathclyde and King Northumbria, they controlled Edinburgh, and Strathclyde had its capital in Govan, ironically, and extended as far south as Carlisle. So I think generally speaking, when you talk about Scotland, you talk about a nation. But a nation, I think, can exist within another nation. And when a nation or a group of them exists within another nation, we just call it a nation state. Mm. There was, although from a cultural perspective, yeah, it's like money. A nation exists if you believe in it. And the intensity of that belief is based on, varies from person to person. And I think that it would have been more honest for the No campaign to portray Britain as a nation and a nation state, mm. rather than to use arguments about the NHS, use arguments, I think, a lot of which were predicated, yes, on fear.
You don't think it was satisfied with the family of nations?
I despise the term family of nations. I don't know if you'd ever watched me while they said that on TV, you'd see part of me just cringe.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, how has it come to this?
I think it's like
from controlling the natives by force to the family of nations.
They use the term family a lot in politics now. I think it's horrible. I think it's a way of getting around addressing classes. But yeah, it does. It's something that makes me, you know, twitch as well. It's not something that I would it's not something that I would prefer to see in the political lexicon. But you know, another talking about, you know, just ways in which I felt that the Yes campaign excelled. I'll give you an example. You know, we obviously had a huge Twitter following, so we were all over various different types of social media, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube were probably the three major ones. But we also had Vine, and you know, I was set to work on quite a few Vines. I would essentially take our bigger promotional ads and videos and things like that, and I would make 6-second clips out of them to put on a Vine. And so I asked, you know, do we have a particularly big following on Vine? And the answer was, well, yes, we do have a following on Vine. But one of the bigger advantages was that because Vine is owned by Twitter, then you could put Vines up on Twitter very easily, and so you could get the Twitter audience to engage with our Vine account.
Unify the message.
Yeah, I mean, that was something that I had never really thought of, and that's just how on the ball everything was at Yes. And it was absolutely top notch. And you know, I was working with the best minds in the country for what we were doing for digital media, and everything was just to a T perfect on what would, you know, would really surprise people in terms of when I first went into the office. I honestly expected it. I did not know what it would be like to go into any type of political campaign office or anything like that. I thought everybody would be screaming and yelling at each other, you know, phones ringing off the hook and people going mental, everybody in a suit and screaming. Like it was like almost the thick of it, except I didn't think it would be that theatrical. I thought it would be quite a charged and high level energy all the time. And yeah, you know, it was a good amount of energy in everywhere. But, you know, 80% of the time, I was just sat around a desk editing videos with other guys who were monitoring Twitter and getting out our messages of the day and stuff. And we're all just kind of sitting around joking about hell, you know, there's the Star Wars reference that you saw on the letter from earlier. It was a lot of fun, you know, a lot of good banter that was around that. And it was a brilliant environment to work in as well, especially because we knew exactly how much progress that we were making. You know, I think initially the support for Yes, National Collective had it about 25%, but I think that 30% was a bit closer to more figures. So we're, you know, distancing between 5% here, 25%. But we increased it to 45% of the vote. Now that's astonishing, a 50% increase or over if you're going by the National Collective figure. That's amazing. And I think a lot of that was just due to our online message, because I think that was the best way for us to get the message out, really. Yeah. Because I don't think, aside from one, the newspapers didn't look upon us very favorably. I think the Daily Record are trying to collect some type of balance.
I think a lot of them, because there were periods in the campaign where people didn't know which way it was going to go. Mm. And I think at the very least, a lot of people by the last, say, 6 months, or maybe the last 4 months of the campaign, knew that it was going to be fairly close.
Right.
That I felt that in the air, that people knew it was going to be fairly close. There was no longer the kind of hubris, I think, that had plagued the No campaign for much of the 2 years.
Mm.
They kind of felt that, and understandably, if you look at the statistics for Yes at the beginning, they sat back and said, well, it doesn't seem very likely that they're going to win.
Yeah.
And I always felt that their overconfidence was very dangerous, because
they had completely underestimated
the amount of effort that good folks such as yourself were prepared to put in to change that.
You know, and I think that was one of the telling parts is, you know, towards the end of the campaign, you saw more of the vows and the Labour Party coming up to Glasgow and Gordon Brown coming out in his emergence. You know, they got pushed back onto the ropes, you know, but they got pushed back onto the ropes by the Yes campaign. And that's one of the more telling things, is you can see exactly when Better Together kind of goes into panic mode,
yeah.
Which I felt that they, you know, they had to do. They had to come up with something better to offer than a simple list of you can'ts.
Yeah.
You know, you can't keep the pound. You can't be in the European Union. Mm. You can't protect your pensions. They had to come up with a more positive case for the union than just a simple list of, well, this is what you can't do.
In the sense that I think that some of the things that Better Together did could be called fear-mongering. Mm. Although, what I would say is that while I believe that some of it was fear-mongering, I would defend them in this way. I would say that if you are the opposition and not the proposition, the onus is not on you to prove anything, although the vote has been as close as it is. And you can interpret this in any number of ways you like. You could say that the closeness of the vote shows that at the very least a significant portion of the Scottish population want change.
Mm.
Or you could also say that the closeness of the vote is bad because it's very divisive, because you have half the country have said one thing and the other half have said another, roughly, give 5%.
Yeah.
You know? And also, because the involvement from people that were not previously involved in politics, their etiquette maybe politically, which I sympathise with because I understand that that's not what they're used to. They're not used to getting involved in politics, and I worry that they have been not permanently, but maybe for a protracted period of time, permanently disillusioned. So it's a temporary permanence, if that makes any sense. disillusioned by politics, because they had their hearts behind those who had been galvanized because of Yes, and there were probably a lot of people who were not previously involved in politics who were galvanized in the idea of a defense of the union, who are now very disappointed, and so that's very dangerous. But what I would say is that if you are the opposition, is the onus on you in an argument, for argument's sake, to provide answers, to provide new ideas to the proposition. So if we were debating God and you said there's a God and I said I don't believe there's a God and you said prove to me that there isn't a God, I can turn around and say the onus is not on me to prove that there is a God because I didn't propose the idea. So I think to some extent the No campaign did not inherently fashion positive messages about Britain because they were not the ones proposing that Britain be broken up. And so that I think was their main mistake. They should, as you've said, try to be more positive, try to promote, a nationalistic or a cultural argument. And they did. They said, oh, we have families and ties going back 300 years.
Yeah, yeah.
But they really needed to expand on that. And as for, when the Labour Party came up to Scotland, it was just nauseating, Ed Miliband. And I still don't think the Prime Minister should have shown his face. They should wheel David Cameron out in Scotland like we wheel the Queen out. You know, just sort of not, don't let him open his mouth, please, because it's going to be bad.
Smile,
but although I would say Gordon Brown's appearance for us in the No campaign when there was a, or the No vote, because I wasn't in the No campaign, of course, because I didn't really feel much, as I've just said, for Better Together as a movement. You can't really call them a movement. They were a campaign, Yes was a movement.
Mm.
And there's a big difference between the two, as I'm sure
you
know.
When
Gordon Brown came out, for those of us who were genuinely worried, and started giving the speeches that he gave, it was very heartening, if you were someone who did intend to vote No as I did. It was very heartening because we hadn't had, Alistair Darling's quite a cold scientific person, whereas Alex Salmond, a guy who I like, and I'm sorry to see him leaving, although I mean that was kind of was going to be the way it was going to go. I have a lot of admiration for him as a person, for following that dream. I have a lot of support, I think, for the SNP's domestic policies.
Yeah.
And I think I would probably consider voting SNP now, because for me, at least for the time being, that card is no longer on the table.
Mm.
And that was probably the main thing that inhibited me from doing so before. But when you look at their domestic policies in the cold light of day, they're actually very good policies.
No, they are extremely good policies.
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm. And when Big Gordon was giving those speeches, it was very heartening for people who were wanting to vote no, because until then we hadn't really had anyone give rousing speeches in favor of no.
Mm.
As we've just said, it was very cold, it was very there were elements of fear in it, but also there was no passion in it. And I think Gordon gave speeches that felt very passionate.
I think you're onto something there. And I was discussing with my sister actually a little while ago, because me and my sister actually both started off as no voters. In fact, I could probably say that the majority of people that I know who became yes voters started out as no voters. And then we both became yes around the same time, and we're, you know, both very favorable. She was out canvassing for the yes campaign, and so both kind of got involved in the campaign from there. But there was something that she said that was, you know, if two people find out that they're both yes voters, then it's a great sense of, oh, oh, you're a yes voter, great man, you know, this is what we're going to do. And it's, but if two people find out they're no voters, you know, what is there to celebrate?
Yeah.
You know, if you find a fellow yes voter, then you and he and you are going to, or you and he are going to try and put in motion a better country. You know, you're moving towards this monumental change for the better. Mm. But if you are no voters, and it's like, oh, you know, so am I.
Well,
you
from
know,
my experience, when I would meet no voters, I would exchange a look with them if I could tell immediately that they were quite politically savvy. Mm. We would exchange a look where in about, you know, 200 milliseconds, we had deduced roughly why we were both voting no for the most part. And if it was one of these, you know, loyalist jingles, I'd know right away and I probably wouldn't be having a conversation with them. But if it was outside the hive or someone like that, we'd exchange a vote that we'd exchange a look that just said, hold the line. It was one of those beginning of Gladiator things where it was just like, strength and honor. You know, because it was like, we knew it was about to be a really vicious campaign in terms of politics. How contentious it was going to be. And it was very difficult, I think, to be a no voter by the 18th of September. Far more difficult to be a no voter than to be a yes voter. And I think because it was if you were someone, it must have been intolerable, by the way, for someone who sat back and said, I don't accept any of the arguments of the Yes campaign. See, I actually accepted the vast majority of the arguments of the Yes campaign.
This. Yeah. No, you and I have talked about independence in depth.
Writhing agony.
You know, being a bartender, I get quite a lot of political chat over the bar as people come in and stuff. And you know, if I were to say to people that I was part of the Yes campaign, it was either one of two reactions. It was either, oh, good on you, man, that's great, or it was, well, why did this person say this about this? You know, like, as if I have some type of direct line to
you're
Nicola
like the
Sturgeon
Borg collective
phone.
From Star Trek. You're
exactly,
all interconnected
exactly.
somehow.
or as if I was like some type of SNP MSP or something. You know, it was just the reactions went entirely two ways for me in any case.
Yeah, no, I mean it's for me. Yeah, it was the reaction. At the same time, as I said earlier, though, it was one of those things where they would give you their reaction, and part of you was like, oh, this is gonna be awkward. But at the same time, you're like, very fortunate to live through this occasion where everyone on every street corner you could ask them and they would have an opinion.
I
find that so inspiring in a way that we were able to do that, and it proved all the people that said that people are apathetic about politics, it proved them all wrong.
See, now you mentioned earlier about people, you know, becoming apathetic again because the vote didn't go their way, and I don't think that's necessarily going to be the case, because I think that in people who have followed politics post-referendum, who are now thinking, okay, well, what are these new powers that we're going to get, I think that people are still going to follow it that way. And I think that for yes voters as well, I don't think that people should give up the fight at all, because I think there's still so much to fight for. You know, it's still my belief that the best way for Scotland to give the most to its people is through self-determination. That is still my belief. And so I think there's still a lot to fight for in terms of the yes vote. And, you know, what has been incredibly interesting, especially being on the digital media team, is seeing the difference in age in the votership.
Yes, yeah, the demographics were very interesting in this referendum.
Yeah. Essentially, it was the over 55 vote that lost the yes campaign the referendum. Mm. I think that we won in every area except for over 55 and up, so 55 to 65 and 65 up. And I think 18 to 24 was very close.
18 to 24 was very close. In hindsight, initially I was like, wow, it was a bad idea for the SNP to push for 16 and 17 year olds to have the vote. I mean, not that it was a bad idea in a moral sense. Yeah. I think that they did deserve the vote.
Oh yeah,
from a demographic sense and a campaign sense, I thought to myself, this is, it looks like they've lost the 16 and 17 year olds. But when the statistics actually came out, it looks as though it was relatively 50-50, 60-40. It was not as polarized to no or polarized to yes as people thought.
No, I think at the 16 and 17 year olds, I think it was about 70% yes.
Was it?
Yeah,
I've heard conflicting reports of that.
I've heard reports
that said that they were overwhelmingly no, and then I would meet enough of them or see enough of them on TV giving their opinions to think, no, I don't think that's true. But then I would also have reports that they were overwhelmingly yes, but then I'd also get people saying it's 50-50.
I have Lord Ashcroft polls here that 71% of 16 to 17 year olds voted yes.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
That is
I'm looking forward to more cohesive statistics coming out in the next couple of months, because you know that there are organizations that live to make statistics. Mm-hmm. And we're going to see some very in-depth ones, I think. coming out in the next couple of months. And there's part of me that kind of loves statistics. I like playing strategy games, so I like number crunching to try and get a better idea of things. And what is that line from Game of Thrones?
That looks like hearts have just scored.
Oh, well, ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening to this in 2 years, a relatively irrelevant football game has just been equalized.
But I think that's very telling in digital media, because I think 55 and up were probably the areas that were least likely to engage in the social media elements of what we were doing in the digital media. And 16 to 17 year olds, I think that, you know, many people thought, you know, they're too young to get into the boat. Yeah. They're too young to do this. And I think that is ridiculous to say.
Because agreed.
You're in education at these points. And so I think that, you know, a lot of people, you're telling me if you and I were in fifth and sixth year at school, so if we were 16 and 17, how many chats do you think that our teachers would give us about the importance of voting, about the importance of going out? It would be endless. It would be always in discussion as well. In every class that you go to from all 5 days out of the week, it would be an extremely engaging atmosphere politically.
Yeah.
And you know, it's my opinion that 16-year-olds should be able to vote anyway.
Yeah. Well, see, the lizard conspiracy corruption part of my brain lights up either way. When I hear someone say, apparently it was overwhelmingly no, which is what I heard, part of the many rumors that I'd heard are apparently untrue. If that's Ashcroft. Ashcroft is YouGov, isn't he? No. Ashcroft is...
I'm not entirely certain.
Ashcroft definitely runs a polling organization. I forget which one it was. But I heard reports say that it was overwhelmingly no. And my first reaction was, okay, good. But then, wait a minute. I mean, I suppose a lot of these kids have been swayed because the UK government runs the education system. Well, and now you saying that it's overwhelmingly yes goes, but then again, the Scottish government has quite a lot of control over the Scottish education system.
Yes.
So it's my head going, they've been influencing these little kids like lab rats, you know.
I bet you that teachers probably got a very lengthy report on tell them to vote, but don't influence their opinion whatsoever.
Well, that's what modern studies is like. The teacher's not really supposed to give a personal political opinion.
Yeah.
Well, you can understand why that happens, but then again, because you condition kids to assume that the person is being impartial, when they get to university and study politics, you have people who leave university having studied political science who will predictably go into the area of politics that their lecturer or their professor held. So that's one of the things they get in America. People say, we have so many liberals because all of the universities, and they have liberal professors, and they're all communists, and they teach all the students to be communists. And that's why you will predictably see where you have conservatives professors in America, that they produce conservative professional class. Mm. They produce a conservative professional class because it's a little bit like history, somebody says, or like martial arts. Someone says, well, I punch like this because I studied under a grandmaster, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And that's what it is. It's the same dynamic at play. And so my initial, as I said, lizard hindbrain kicks into gear and says, who's been fucking around with the kids, you know? I did think the constant appeals to emotion for the sake of small children from both sides of this debate was pretty repugnant. I think there's something creepy about appealing to children, because the politician knows that you care.
I'm assuming you mean appealing to parents, not appealing to children.
That's what I mean.
Children.
Appeal for the sake of children, you say, you know, and obviously the No campaign did a lot of this because it was fear-based, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it was this appeal to emotion for the sake of children. All politicians in every country in the world do this, and there's something really dishonest about it, because you're asking people to think with their hearts and not with their heads, and that's an integral part of politics. But your heart should be informed by what your head tells you.
But I think
way around.
I think that on the yes part, I think that appeals to parents were in very good cause, because we were opposing childcare.
Yeah,
it's such a huge lengthy childcare policy, which of course is going to go hand in hand.
The SNP have done a lot for childcare already, I think, though, haven't they? Campaign on.
Which makes an extreme amount of sense to me, because it's a great way to open up a workforce as well, to get people, you know, to get mothers who have taken time off. To go into work and things. I think it just makes sense to have a very good childcare policy.
One of the elements of the white paper
extremely good part of the French political system as well. Mm. Childcare is absolutely astounding.
It's very important, I think, since something like childcare. I'm not particularly interested in having children, but I'm very concerned about other people's children, so long as they don't disturb me on the bus when I'm trying to listen to my music.
Well,
in which case, shut your fucking kids up, please.
Christ.
They're not my children. I didn't choose to have them. No, but I am concerned in all honesty about children. But I think the idea of using political discourse, one of the reasons, this is my theory, I could be wrong, that the, you said the 55 to 65s voted against
independence,
because they,
50, any group above 55,
they're very self-absorbed. Most of them are I mean, the people who are in their 60s right now are baby boomers, and the baby boomers, having crashed the economy, you might argue voted yes because they want an easy way out. But then the people who are younger than them, their motivations are I think just as self-absorbed. Their motivations are, well, my pension's coming through in 10 years, and I don't want, even though whatever, you could have a debate saying the pensions were safe, the pensions weren't safe, and I didn't want to get myself dragged down in that minutiae. I think if Scotland had declared independence, a lot of that stuff would have been hashed out.
Oh, of course. You can get your pension,
because all these organizations would have reoriented themselves to the new reality. If there had been independent Scotland, these banks would have said, well, okay, maybe a couple of us might move operations. For example, I think if they had moved operations, if we take them at their word, I don't agree with the position of the Yes campaign that said that no jobs would be lost, because I think that they would have been lost necessarily. Would loads and loads of them be lost? Probably not. But they would have, some jobs would have been lost. I mean, Nicola Sturgeon gave a speech in 2007, griping and worrying that the movement of, I forget which company it was, would directly cause job losses in Scotland, and it was in financial services. And so I think, but then again, you could say the same thing about the No campaign, and it was this backwards and forwards thing, but on the currency union.
But I'll let you finish. To go for that, I mean, I don't think that these organisations would let Scotland become the lost marketplace. It's just not when.
Agreed.
That was a big pain in the ass part about, you know, all of these companies coming out for a no vote towards the end. I didn't realise that ASDA had a vote. So I don't think that they, and you know, if they said that they were going to, you know, raise prices in an independent Scotland, well, that just seems ridiculous to me. And if only there were multiple competitors to ASDA.
Yes.
Of course they wouldn't raise prices.
I didn't accept the price thing.
People would go to Sainsbury's.
The only way that they could have raised prices would have been as a result of the effects of government policy in Scotland. But the Scottish government would have had to consciously make a decision to add a regulation or to add a policy that would lead to the raising of prices. Mm. I think if they hadn't, the prices would have remained largely the same. They cited the Republic of Ireland, and they said, well, prices are different there. I don't agree with that. The reason for that is because the infrastructure is different in the Republic of Ireland.
But salaries are pretty good in Ireland as well. So
yeah, but you have to transport. It's the infrastructure of the way things move. You have to get the goods to the country in a completely different fashion than you do in the UK, which has the Channel Tunnel and has all these other elements, and also, you know, big shipping hub around the southeast of England, and the English Channel and all that kind of stuff, the North Sea. And so those prices are different for a reason. And again, yeah, wages, I mean, is something being more expensive as much of an issue if you get paid more, you know? Mm. But I didn't want to get dragged down into the minutiae, and I won't now, of currency, because having gallivanted around the libertarian right and then come back to the light partially, as I have. And mine, by the way, my main reason for coming back to the light is that I couldn't sort of fix an issue I was having, which was that no matter how free market and effective a society was, it could not guarantee an equality of opportunity, because even if medical care was a pound, your limit to medical care would still be £1, and if you didn't have £1, you wouldn't be able to get medical care. Whereas in a society where something is free at the point of use, whether you have a job or not, you can ultimately guarantee that 100%. And that was where I was unable to reconcile that reality in free market libertarianism. So I had to backpedal out of it. But backpedal sort of implies that I came back with nothing. I think I came back with a lot of values that the social democratic left, which I've now reassociated myself with partially, don't have. And that transition happened over the last 6 months, ironically, right in the middle of this campaign. So both 3 months ago, I started saying, well, put the two together. What do you have, having come back out of libertarianism? And what I had was federalism, which was not smaller government overall, but more decentralized government. Mm. So you decrease the overall punching power of one centralized unitary state. And that's a podcast I'm going to be doing next week, actually.
Okay, I see. But I think, of course, there would have been a currency union. It was too much in the interest of both countries for there not to be a currency union.
Yes, yes.
And even still, you know, even if people voted yes and then decided they wanted their own currency, they could vote for whatever party to come in to set up a Scottish pound or anything. That was one of the beauties of the yes vote.
On that note, because I didn't get onto it, the reason I wasn't interested in it, because my gallivantings around that area of politics have left me very cynical about our monetary system. So I don't agree with fiat currency. I don't think it's I'm a Bitcoin guy, but guy who's in favor of anything that doesn't involve printing loads of fake money and basing its value on the housing market.
Which is basically what both sides were advocating. They said
we'll be lucky because we get to keep the pound. I'm like, what, you mean the currency that has you £1.4 trillion in debt? Have fun, bro. You know, but then for the pro independence guys to say we're very progressive, we're very forward thinking, which they were on a lot of issues, and said, and on top of all that, the icing on the cake is we'd like to keep fiat currency. And I'm like, you've got to be fucking kidding me. But you know, I can understand, because pensions, because the housing market, and I think that's one of the reasons that they lost the 55 to 65 year olds, because those people are very self-absorbed, they're at the end of their careers, they might be on a pretty pay package, maybe they're a public sector worker, and they're worried for their own interest, not for the interest of their children. So clearly the children remarks didn't get through to them.
Yeah.
On either side. Or maybe it was just the think of the children remarks from the No campaign that got through to them, if at all, which I doubt, because you have one of the most entitled generations ever, our parents and grandparents' generations, I would argue. Not that they're bad people, just that as a generation, they have kind of crashed the economy of their own country, just a little bit, and may have involved themselves, maybe brought the country's reputation internationally into disrepute as well. But us hoodies, we're the problem.
I got
a job. We exported all the jobs to China. Get a job.
I will. I'll bring this along. There was a day at the Yes campaign where. I was at the Yes campaign and they'd sent me through to Edinburgh to do one of our events launching. It was Lawyers for Yes, on which I filmed the video for it, and you know, got to meet everybody and this group of lawyers who were in support of Yes, for obviously the title Lawyers for Yes. Yeah. And so that was where I met Alison Bolhari, who was very good to both you and I.
Indeed, in
coming later. And so later on, Alison emails me asking if I'd like to get involved in something called Referendum TV. And we go down and we have this meeting in a Freemasons hall about, which of course wasn't anything related to the Freemasons. It was just a venue. Mm. And then I get you involved. I get Lewis
you do indeed.
Involved.
You get me, a no voter who is a yes voter in almost every other respect apart from my latent unionism and British nationalism, to directly involve myself in a pro-yes TV show.
It's one of my greater achievements of the entire campaign. I got Lewis involved in a pro-yes YouTube show. Let's talk about Referendum TV, Lewis.
Let's.
And we'll have to preface this by saying that so many of the people that were on the show, so many of the people that were behind the scenes and running the show, were absolutely fantastic.
Yes.
Ian McWhorter and Leslie Rick were both absolutely brilliant. Alison Bolhari, who was our editor, was just off the wall amazing. She's a very interesting person.
Yes.
Absolutely very interesting.
Sarah Beattie Smith,
yeah,
in addition to being incredibly talented and an all-round lovely person, had a sort of silent sexual power,
which cannot be understated. I'm sure she'd
love
to hear that.
And I hope she listens to this lovely person as she is. Yes, silent sexual power.
Sarah Beattie Smith was brilliant. Yes. Pat Kane was absolutely hilarious.
Pat Kane was awesome.
Now,
yeah,
everything about it just seemed like a tremendous recipe for success. If you haven't seen Referendum TV, essentially it was kind of a fringe show that was a daily chat about the referendum, and we got on various different guests who were both yes and no. I mean, we did have a fair whack of no voters on as well, about their opinions on the referendum, and we had people coming on talking about land ownership. That was Andy Whiteman who came and talked about land ownership.
I loved that. It was great.
That was about reforming the entire idea of land ownership. We had people, English Scots for Yes. We had Alex Massey who came on. It was tremendous.
Alex Massey was great. Was like a cold, unforgiving Hitchens replica. he was great. He just came on just cold, heartless, callous cynicism. It was beautiful.
We had Simon Peon as well, who's a lecturer of mine, and he's absolutely, it's just a top notch bloke.
The guys with maps, who were those guys again?
They were
cartographers. They were architects, but they dabbled for the sake of the referendum and a bit of cartography.
They had made essentially a Scottish atlas about what an independent Scotland could be going forward. And so, you know, right from just, you know, these names that we're listing off, it's a very varied, it's a great idea for a show. But essentially where it fell flat was in its approach to digital media, which was especially frustrating given that the Yes digital media was so good.
Yeah.
Referendum TV is probably the greatest show about the referendum that you haven't seen.
And that you probably shouldn't watch. I mean, I mean, Mike, the problem with you, Mike, is that you're too polite for your own good.
No, I mean, the
people involved in this show, from Alison Balhari to Ian McWhirter to Leslie Riddick to Sarah Beattie Smith and Pat Kane and all the rest of them, were all fantastic. Yeah. Karen Kelly, who was also great and a pleasure to work with.
Brilliant.
You know, and had a great sense of humor. It was awesome to hang out with her for two and a half weeks that we were doing that show. The problem with this show was the people who both had the idea and essentially carried it off, I think, rather poorly and incompetently at the top of this pyramid of otherwise gold. At the top was a pile of feces rotting in the cold light of day. Right at the top, where the sun hit, was where the stench was most potent.
We'll give you an idea. Essentially, the show was all to be done through this website, referendumtv.net, where it'd be a live stream every day, and because it was so focused on going through this website, it left very little room for expansion into other areas. For example, we couldn't really advertise our YouTube page very well. If you went onto our YouTube, it would just say Referendum TV 15/8, so the 15th of August episode, and it would just continue like that throughout it. So we couldn't say Referendum TV with George Folks or anything like that. So all the videos were titled very badly because it wasn't meant for YouTube, which is actually probably the area in which I think we were getting
exactly close. I mean, if you're listening to this and you're someone who makes YouTube videos themselves and is halfway decent at doing so.
Oh, Stephen Payton.
Stephen Payton could tell you better than I can tell you, potentially, about how important it is to get your analytics right, to get your AdWords right, to get your title right, to get your thumbnail right, to get your description right and your links right, and to unify that brand as well. And that message, and have it interchangeable, have it flexible.
I mean, component parts, the
whole is more than the sum of its component parts, but if the component parts are one, referendumtv.net, then it's going to fall flat on its face. And the kind of talent they had, they just completely squandered it.
I said to you earlier, Vine was a big part of Yes Scotland because we could work through our Twitter, which was our biggest following. You know, this interconnectivity throughout all of your digital media and social media outlets is so key these days. But this was to be done through a website.
Yes.
Our Facebook page didn't really have much going for it because you were supposed to use the chat room on the website. We should have had an Indiegogo that was... we do have an Indiegogo. It was successful in going through, but there should have been more uniform support for an Indiegogo.
Yes.
But there wasn't supposed to be because it was a donate thing on the website.
Yes.
Our Twitter was actually, you know, it was pretty lively. I think they had to concede that people were speaking about this on Twitter. So our Twitter did have some success, but we still weren't allowed to post episodes on Twitter. We weren't allowed to post our episodes onto Twitter, which would have been so much better because people could have retweeted it, our followers, and then other people could have seen it, and it just would have grown quite naturally from that. But no, everything was to be done through this website, and that was ultimately the pretty much downfall, is that I think the heads of Referendum TV, they fell on their sword, really, in that they pushed far too much in keeping this onto a website when that's not really the way that people use digital media nowadays, and especially in the referendum. If you want to know anything about the referendum on either side, you go onto Twitter and you put in hashtag #IndieRef.
Yes.
And then if Referendum TV was on that, it would have been fantastic.
And don't misinterpret this, guys. I mean, the idea that you might think that these people at the top of this pyramid of otherwise glittering gold, topped with a pile of feces, were uninterested. They had no self-interest, personal self-interest. No personal self-interest was involved in this, and they were doing it for the sake of the website, and oh, be damned how important it is, just as long as it's done. You know, you can't take back the words you never said, and that's the kind of honorable way to go around that kind of failure. But the way they did it was purely based on self-interest and monetary interest as well. I mean, this is neither defamatory or libelous, that one of the gentleman that was involved in the campaign or in the TV show was, I mean, he was a convicted tax dodger and an all-around weird guy who kind of was constantly trying to shoehorn his own bullshit into the show and partially manipulating the woman who was rather incompetently from a technical standpoint for the most part that the show was running for, messing it up, but was kind of manipulating her as well. It was a strange dynamic to work in.
I mean, I think there was an idea that
we have the documents by the way. The guy is a tax dodger, so none of that is illegal.
There was a lot of talk of potentially moving that to TV when I thought that was just totally out of the question, and it was never what anybody had really signed up for. There was talk about trying to get it more regulated, trying to get all the guests and things to sign off on agreements that we could use their stuff for whatever, and you know, it was quite weird because I don't think that they tried to see a very different big picture as to what we did, because I don't think they believed in digital media. I don't think they believed in Twitter and Facebook. They thought that they could do it on their own a bit better. Yeah. It's like if somebody, you know, that could have been a very successful thing 10 years ago, but you know, today, no, that's just not the way that people
I half expect this. In 2 years to find reruns of it on some obscure Russian TV channel.
it was very bizarre because I think there was so much goodwill. So many of the guests were great. Obviously, everybody that was involved aside from the top were just great. And you know, it was a great learning experience as well. But there were some things. I edited a few videos that just never saw the light of day, and it was a real shame. I think the only thing that I did out with the actual 1 hour show every day that actually saw it, the only two things that I did the intro and the outro, and those were the only things that actually saw the light of day on the TV. And also, God, the technical difficulties.
Did our Radical Independence rally ever get put out?
That was what I was referring to. No, it never did get put out, which was annoying as hell, because you know, it was you and I and Sarah that
took
all the bus out there.
We got a fucking bus
there,
for God's sake.
Yeah.
That's like £3, £50 either way. Yeah. I'm out of pocket.
And nothing
referendum TV.
And it was really crap because I remember, you know, everybody pushed so hard for us to really promote our YouTube, really, you know, spice it up and do everything. Yeah. But by the time that actually got through to people, it was over.
Poor Stephen by the end of it. Yeah, the guy was at his wit's end trying to convince this woman to, I mean, the antiquated outlook that these two had was it was abominably harmful to the show. Yeah. It was insane. It was dangerous. I mean, I could use the metaphor about the cliche about the lunatics taking over the asylum. It's as if the lunatics were transplanted from the upper echelons of the asylum's leadership, where they had created this weird coven cult-like environment and brought to the top of the pyramid that overlooks a university or something that something that's filled with very competent, well-meaning people.
Yeah, I mean,
not necessarily including myself in that, but because it'd be a little big-headed to do so. But and then transplanted and stuck at the top of that pyramid, and just put in a position where they could just put a hex on the whole damn thing. I mean, the amount of opportunities that were lost to get people who had fantastic things to say, very interesting things to say, who essentially don't exist. I mean, you don't. Information online is what makes you exist. You were saying, I think, months ago when you interviewed me for Impulse Magazine, that you're putting a message in a bottle out to a sea of messages and bottles.
Yeah.
And the information attached to that message is how big the bottle is. That's what that translates to. And if there's virtually no information, the bottle might as well not exist.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, approaching things through the website was just a really bad idea. And they tried continuing Referendum TV. I think they did
it was great. It was one of the best things, folks.
Okay,
I'm going to link it. I think they've taken down Scottish Six, although it might still be on that YouTube channel.
The Scottish Six, no, if they've taken it down, it was an embed on the YouTube. It was an embedded YouTube video. That's why they use YouTube in general, because it's the easiest thing to embed and to stream through. If they could have done it without using YouTube and given us that tiny glimmer of hope, they would have. If they could have used it without YouTube and taken away our glimmer of hope, then that would have happened. But then they went in to do the Scottish Six as well. Essentially, everybody that we listed off that made it a really great success left. Everybody by the end of the 2 weeks, they were done. They didn't agree to sign up any further.
It was like a weird alternate reality watching that show, because it took place in the same studio, that weird Masonic hall that we were using during the festival.
No. I think it might be there now, but the Scottish Six stuff was not done at the Hill Street Theatre. Mm. It was on Hill Street. It was in one of the offices.
The In Conversation series that they made.
Oh, that's. I think that's the one that it may still be going.
And also going from now. A no perspective, folks, if you voted no, or even if you voted yes and you just have a hell of a sense of humour, watch the 7.5 hour live results, the results live stream that they made. Have you seen this?
No,
it's a 7.5 hour show. of two people sitting on a sofa with nothing coming up on the screen. You're not seeing any statistics. They appear to lean forward occasionally to look at what seems to be a laptop, where they're seeing the results coming through on the BBC website, and they're just talking.
You can skip through four hours later,
and it's the same people on the couch just having the most tired, like they've run out of things to talk about completely. And this appears to have happened based on the number of hours in the film about an hour and a half ago. An hour and a half ago, they've run out of shit to talk about, and now they're just like, I mean, yeah. And I'm like, this is the worst piece of programming I've ever seen together in my life.
One of the major strengths that it had as referendum TV throughout the festival was that there were journalists involved, which was always great, you know, in the interviewing process, of course, to have journalists involved. And, you know, even Stephen Payton as well was brilliant. He's not a journalist, but he was absolutely fantastic. Michelle Rennie and Pat Kane, other people that we had on that weren't journalists, were still very good in that respect. But Ian McWhirter and Leslie Riddick were very, you know, they're journalists, they're interview driven. When you take that away, when you take the journalistic element out of referendum TV, I'm not sure what the appeal is, especially if they're doing a Scottish Six, because you're doing a new show without any journalists, and that seemed far-fetched. And
bizarre,
there was so many. When they did the Scottish Six, they had a virtual setup of the BBC studio, and it was essentially a desk that had just a regular wooden desk that they had essentially green screened into the BBC desk, and everything around them was turned into green screen, and it looked abysmal.
It was horrible.
BBC could probably sue them for it.
Yeah.
For use if they own the image of the studio. It was awful. There were so many technical
and they had the overlays in white on a white background, so you couldn't read anything on the video overlay at all that was coming up on the screen. But if you don't know, the video overlay is that little snazzy box you see on video. You know, they do it for BBC as well with some things where they'll have, you know, to the left of the presenter is a picture,
a small photo
of what they're talking about. They were doing stuff like that where it had text in the box and the background was white and the text was white. And like, you know, a novice at using MS Paint could tell you that that's not how you make a poster for your barbershop. You know what I mean? It's crazy.
Really, really badly done. And I think they scrapped it and then took it all down and just had to rework it. But, you know, that was part of the divide at the end, is that they wanted to continue. And I think everybody saw that saw the iceberg coming and wanted to jump off, because there was so little cohesion between one vision and the other. And I think it was unanimous in everybody else really wanted this to be a successful entity within the August Hill Street referendum TV show, but beyond that they didn't want anything to do with it.
Well, I don't know about you, but when I left, I felt not unfortunate by any stretch, because of some of the people I'd met there, Alison Balhari, namely, Karen and other people, you know, Sarah Beattie Smith, Ian McWhirter to some extent, Leslie Riddick to some extent, they're both great as well, but I felt sort of like, oh, thank God that's over. And it was sort of like, well, you know, it could have gone better.
And I had an element of negativity
to the way I looked at it. And then a few weeks later, when I looked at Scottish Six, I felt to myself, I feel so sorry for the people who are now involved in this project because this is even more of a train wreck than it was for you and me.
With us, I felt, and with what we did, I don't feel it was an entire train wreck, because I felt that...
At
the end of the day, it was a good show. The content was there.
Yes.
I felt that they lost the
content. That was the most infuriating part about it, that the content was there.
They lost the content when everybody left. Mm. And I returned to Yes Scotland after that 2-week period, and it was just like... It was like, you know, Dorothy comes out into the Land of Oz. Everything's in color and here's where everything makes sense, and this is why I'm doing this video, because we can reach out to these people about this, and everything just
the content got lost in the mists of incompetence.
The
content was nowhere to be seen because of how pronounced the incompetence
which was a shame to everybody who put in a lot of effort into
this.
I don't necessarily regret it,
neither do I.
it was a stressful experience, because it seemed impossible to get through.
Yeah, I wouldn't erase it from my memory. I mean, the comedy value, the comedy value is tremendous. You know. But shall we wrap this up? I think.
Because we have
been going for about an hour. If there was anything else you'd like to talk about, I think.
Somebody had said this to me, that it was the wrong result, but we were on the right side, and I absolutely wholeheartedly agree. I worked with Yes Scotland, I worked with the best people in the country for what we were doing in digital media, and that was an astounding experience. I could not put it into words how amazing it was to leave a fingerprint, however small it was, on the campaign. And I think that what was was done at ES Scotland, especially in my department, especially in the digital media, will be looked at for the next century in terms of a turning point in how digital media became so successful in politics and how that can really engage people. So the work that I bore witness to was absolutely astounding, and I were the best.
One thing I would say is that whether or not, you know, so this campaign ultimately was unsuccessful for Yes, but what I would say is that I think it may have set a new benchmark for how a civic argument about self-determination should be conducted in the 21st century. And I think there are a lot of countries that are seeking, that who will seek this in the future, who may take quite a few leaves out of Yes's book as to how to conduct one in the future, how the discourse should be, how the campaign should be conducted, the use of things, as we said, like social media, and the overall message, one of, you know, change and all that kind of stuff, and not, as has been seen from elements of the Yes side, but probably not people who were directly involved in the campaign, elements of chauvinism, which were very disturbing. But these, unlike almost every other referendum for independence or every other movement for independence, not all of which have been settled by a referendum, like Ireland in 1921, largely bullets, you know, thankfully it was the opposite here. It was a great 21st century example of something that hadn't really been seen before. As Alex Salmond often said, it was a civilized discourse and debate for the overwhelming amount of time that it was a debate and that there was discourse in the run-up. So I'm very proud to have been in Scotland to live through this great era, I think. And so thanks, man, a lot for coming on the show today.
I've really enjoyed
the conversation. If you liked the conversation, please hit the like button. Please share this on all relevant social networking and media sites. And subscribe if you're feeling generous. Thank you very much for listening. I have been Lewis Hamilton. This has been Mike Miller.
I've been Michael Miller.
Yeah, thanks a lot for listening, folks.